The FSAE is an international competition between universities worldwide. The goal is to design and build an autocross racer and basically try and design something that is as fast as possible, but also as cheap as possible, and something that can be driven by students.
Our team, at competition, our results weren't as great as we would have liked. We had a lot of setbacks.
We definitely did worse this year. We were down 10 or 12 places from last year.
Our issue was indeed the same issue that plagued us last year, was that the car was having problems hot starting. The most important event at our competition is the endurance event. It's a very long event. It's very, very hard on the car. Like, unquestionably, that is the biggest challenge for any team participating in a Formula SAE event.
The total scores are made up in the endurance events, and if we don't finish those, we lose a lot of points, and that kind of puts us towards the middle of the pack.
This has been a problem for the team for several years, just the hot start. When you pull in after flogging the car, you're allowed to pause for 3 to 5 minutes as you change drivers, and then you have to restart within that time window.
Well, I think we went to competition believing that we had a car that was able to get through the endurance event and could start hot. At least I was led to believe that we had gone through the paces on that.
I'm feeling pretty darn confident. As far as the dynamic racing events go, I think we've got a really good shot this year. We've got the car consistently hot starting pretty well today. So that was our big stumbling block last year, was we were having hot start issues. Seemed to have ironed them out with a good tune, and I think that we've got a good shot out there.
I think working with students, generally, you have to take things with a grain of salt and had enough experience. When you get a summary of results and says, hey, the car ran, X number of hours perfectly and hot started consistently. And then you go to competition and suddenly we've got problems after all this testing, and you say, well, is this really a surprise to all of us, or is it only a surprise to me?
The issue with the development cycle is that when you design a Formula SAE car, you don't have time to develop the systems. So some teams do actually run a 2-year development cycle. They only compete every other year. We've never really considered that, and I don't think we will. Basically, you dream up a design, you make it up in SolidWorks, you make sure it meets the rules, and you build it, and then you pretty much hope for the best. There's not a lot of progressive development you can do on an existing chassis. I mean, you just don't have time. And then the next year, you have to start afresh.
There's a huge spectrum of cars that show up. Some are basically a small step down from a professional racing outfit. And then there's other teams like us that are basically enthusiasts, where we do all the work on evenings and weekends.
And we have kind of the environment where students are pretty much on their own. There's not a passion within our department or within the faculty or within the university. And they'd like to see it successful, but I don't think there's not a lot of people counting on it. We don't have the sort of support that the solar team would have. We have got a lot better, I think. I mean, I think the 2009 car had the best potential. We came very, very close to getting in the top 10, which for us would have been a major accomplishment.
The big issue is turnover. And that was the very end of a string of years that were run by basically the same team. While they were the heart of the team and basically designed the entire colleges themselves, there wasn't a lot of first year, second year, third year members. So when they left, that was a significant chunk of the team evaporating.
And so there's always a relearning process that every year the team goes through. And that's probably a roadblock to developing new and novel concepts, just relearning basics, relearning things that haven't worked in the past, but you didn't know about it, so you unwittingly repeat the same mistake.
Great for indoors.
In previous years, the car has traditionally been done a couple days before leaving, and drivers barely had any time to become familiar with the car. We were barely done troubleshooting, or maybe weren't done troubleshooting at all, so there were a lot of small mechanical problems that would prevent the car from finishing a race.
So I took it as a personal challenge to try to get us through that hurdle. You know, implement more testing. That was always something that the car would never be done in enough time to do thorough testing. So trying to police the schedule a little bit closer to ensure we got time for testing. And
which from a development perspective, definitely is pretty good. You need to stay very, very focused. One change at a time, take it to the track, try it. Evaluate it, come back in, evaluate it some more, get some feedback from the driver, what the inputs were like, what the outputs in the car were as a result of the driver inputs, and then, like I say, and then evaluate and make your changes from there.
To be honest, we haven't ever got to that stage. We've always sort of botched up the more fundamental things, like we just don't get the car around the track. I think one of the problems is the drivers just don't get to spend a lot of hours in the car, and sometimes almost none. We have actually had situations where a person was driving the car for the first time at the competition, maybe doing a minor event, but you know, that's not really the way to do things.
That's basically make or break, because you can have a very inexperienced driver in the best car there, and those times won't be nearly as impressive as a really great driver in even one of the worst cars.
When you're developing a car, it's very important that the person that sits in the seat is the same person going out, coming back in, giving the feedback. Is the car understeering? Is it oversteering? Does it have a flat spot and acceleration? Are they hitting their marks where they do laps, the same marks over and over and over? Because if you don't have somebody consistent in the cockpit, it's very, very difficult to make any changes that have any value, that are gonna make you go faster and live longer. So I think that that's probably one of the things that kills the teams a bit in the development aspect of it.
A big challenge for us in Canada especially is that we don't have the rather glorious weather conditions they do down in the southern states where a lot of these competitions happen. So we don't get the ability to do year-round testing. So our testing regimen has to be done over a couple of months tops.
The plan in the beginning of this season was to keep the previous car running for driver training and then design and build the new car at the same time. Unfortunately, that didn't happen.
Now, the problem was with our car is we ended up having to scavenge a lot of parts off of it. It had a lot to do with parts that didn't come in, parts that didn't get finished design soon enough. We had team members sort of drop out on us that were in charge of certain design elements that again we had to scavenge.
The deal was with the team was, okay, you're taking some parts off temporarily, but we want it reassembled. And we were assured of that, that was going to happen. But once that process started, just more and more parts kept coming off, and it was easy to recognize that at some point this car was never coming back together.
Here before you guys, they should be ashamed of themselves by keeping
the judges around. Love to see innovation. That's a really, I mean, that's a fantastic thing to have on your vehicles. Have an innovative part, have an innovative system, design overall, that's great.
Like, the whole premise of the competition is to design and build a car that can be sold to the weekend autocrosser. And we weren't able to explain to the judges in great technical detail everything they wanted to know. So we didn't get great engineering marks for that aspect. And they also frown on the reuse of components, as we heavily did this year.
I mean, basically, the 2010 car ended up being no further advanced than the 2009 car. Okay, it was a new car. They went, the students learned a lot going through the process of designing and building. And there were some things that were improved. Certainly the original plan that they presented in fall was a lot more aggressive than what they were actually able to execute.
But that being said, it's not all about design. There's also the racing aspect. And for the key event, Endurance, which is a 22-kilometer race, a lot of the very best teams were having issues in Endurance and were dropping out before completing. So as the Endurance day went on, we saw that a door was opening where teams that could finish with a competitive time would have huge jumps up the scoreboard. And as our turn rolled around, we were hopeful that we'd be able to make some sort of a jump if we were able to finish the race. So things were looking really good. The car was running great, lots of power, handling was dialed in pretty nicely. And then I completed my half of the race, pulled in for driver change, and the car just wouldn't start this year.
I think it was a gamble. I mean, I think there was a fair probability that it would have, or that it could have. We still wouldn't have made it into the top 10. I think we were weak on some other dimensions. Some of our presentations were maybe not as strong as they could have been. I don't know. I don't regret going to competition. For team continuity, I think we pretty much, I think it's pretty serious not to.
Mainly because no one wants to take a year off and say, we're not going to do any racing, we're just going to design. For a team of enthusiasts, that's not an appealing way to go about, because everyone wants to build a car and go race, completely understandably.
And I don't have any good answers on what we should be doing differently. I mean, theoretically, I know that we should be following our design review process and our, you know, project management aspects and our testing and all this more rigorously, but how do you actually execute it?
So well, now we've got that learning under our belt. Now it's time to get this new team we've started, get the fresh members and say, okay, it's time to move forward from where we have, it's time to get even better. So I have huge hopes for the next year and even far beyond that.
And but 2007, 2008, 2009, 2010, and we're still working at it. So it's been frustrating as the faculty advisor, but it's been even more frustrating for the team members who have put in just thousands of hours of work.
Well, Randy, I'm out here because a couple of the guys on the University of Calgary Formula SAE team, Shawn Madro and Matt Glanzer, have recently joined our Pro Formula Mazda race team. We talked to one another, and they told me about the SAE program, and they were involved in it. And I figured I'd come on out and see what it's all about, because it's just kind of cool. Basically, the automotive petri dish out here. It's saying, you try this, does it work, does it try that, and are we quicker, are we slower, what's longevity like, so. It's really what we do at the higher levels of motorsport, but the financial consequences here are much, much lower. They're very keen. They like race cars. They like race car dynamics. One of the reasons why we, in fact, brought them over to the team is purely because, you know, these guys that take their own initiative to learn about race car dynamics are kind of guys that that we want on our team. So, and although no experience on a racing level, keen we can do something with. You're not keen, I can't do anything with that.